Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you that we get to come to church. What a privilege it is. God, that we get to come into the house of God, that we get to come, we get to celebrate, we get to hear your word, Lord, and we get to be directed. Lord, we don't come to hear from a man or from a woman. We don't come for the old or for the young. Truly in this house, we come for you. We come to hear the direction of the Holy Spirit through the words and the teachings of Jesus, who we acknowledge as the leader of this house. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray that your Holy Spirit would speak to us today, minister to us. Lord, I need your Holy Spirit tonight more than ever. And, Lord, we thank you that as we come into this place, Lord, it's not the words of a man. Lord, it's not the suggestions of a preacher. But, Lord, these are the words of Almighty God, inspired by the Holy Spirit, penned down for us by the usage of men, that we might live according to your will and your way. So, Father, I pray that you would teach us and direct us and motivate us and direct us in your word, that we might be pleasing to you, Father, and we might live a fulfilled life through Jesus. And Lord, thank you for the privilege of being here. We ask that you bless all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said,
Amen.
As you take your seats, go with me. We're going to just take a couple of minutes today. And I just thought what I'd do is just kind of take you through a devotional, basically, that I was going through, some study times. You know, the past couple of weeks have been hard. Have you ever had one of those weeks that's just like frustrating? Just kind of like, I know, it's kind of funny because 2 weeks ago I taught about when bad things happen to good people. And it's just like, you know, it's just kind of the kickoff of this just like, a couple of weeks. And, you know, I was going through my devotionals and I found myself in a place and, you know, I don't want to get political. I really don't. I'm not going to use the pulpit for politics. But, you know, I found myself in a place over the past couple of weeks of being greatly dissatisfied with the direction of our nation. And I know that, you know, there's a lot of different people. There's a lot of different diversity in the church and the body of Christ. And so I know that I'm not going to try to say one thing or the other based on the political direction. But I just know that in my own heart and my own desire, where I was hoping that the nation would go and coming back and hearing these things. And I'm not a person that typically reads the news or watches the news. I try to stay as far away from the news as I possibly can, just because I don't feel like it contributes anything positive to life. But I just found myself really down, really frustrated, really discouraged as far as, you know, what's going on? What happened to this country, so to say, that, you know, our money says in God we trust? And we saw that video on the 4th of July about some of our founding fathers that were great Christian men and women, and some of our founding fathers were just great believers of God and his sovereignty. And it just seems like, where did we go? Where did we miss? And in my own heart, in my own life, I was incredibly frustrated. You know, you might have some feelings of relation to that, you know, just the things that have gone on with the California legislature lately and our freedoms and what we can and cannot do and what we can and cannot say and what we can and cannot do with our children and so forth and so on, and with the whole Supreme Court ruling. And like I said, I don't want to get political. It's not a political message, so you can take a big deep breath. But I was just really frustrated, really just kind of, you know, 4th of July came, we watched the fireworks, we watched the video, we played patriotic music during the fireworks show, but I just kind of leaned over to Stacey and I was just like, man, I just don't feel like celebrating. I don't feel very patriotic, I don't feel very happy about red, white, and blue right now, and there was just all this kind of turmoil on the inside of me, and I began to go into the Word of God, I began to just study out, you know, of course, like everybody 2 weeks ago, you know, I was tempted to just kind of plaster social media with my own personal opinions. And you know, I thought it was kind of funny. Like 2 weeks ago, somebody put on one of their accounts, it looked like the Confederate flag got in a fight with a Skittles bag and all this stuff, because it was just, everything was all over. I mean, the nation is going crazy. And so, you know, I just kind of kept silent. I just went to the Word. I went to prayer, and I was just kind of feeling these frustrations. And as I was going into the Word of God, I just felt like God really began to speak to me on some things in my own heart and my own life that I believe God wanted to kind of share with us today. Some alignment, some perspective in our own lives about, you know, this nationality that we have. And when I say nationality, it's kind of this allegiance to this great country. And again, I say it's not political, because you'll see where I'm going in just a moment. But, you know, we have to understand that this is a country that, despite being founded on godly principles, was a country founded by men, ruled by men, orchestrated by men, elected by men. And with that understanding, we have to understand that the nation that we live in, I believe with all of my heart that this great nation that we live in, without a doubt, despite the decision, despite the direction that we are going in, is still the greatest nation on the face of the earth. And I believe that God's hand is upon this nation. And you know, you might find yourself in the same type of type of feelings that I was going through the past couple of weeks. You know, you might be on the opposite end of the spectrum and celebrating and thinking great for civil rights and so forth and so on. Or you know what? You might be indifferent. I was talking to my wife, Stacy, and she was saying, I really just don't care. And you know, that might be you in this place as well. One thing I realized, though, is that despite that, God showed some things in my heart when I was reading his scriptures about my heart and where my allegiance was and where my mindset was, because there's this the idea of citizenship, and that's a hot topic in our nation. But ultimately, I was reading the words of Jesus, and this realization came upon me that my perspective, my alignment, was out of alignment with where God wanted me to be. And I want to just take you there through this devotion, through this Bible study time of what God took me on in this journey to help give me some comfort. Because, you know, some of us are happy, some of us are sad, some of us are rejoicing, some of us are you know, waiting for the thunder and the lightning, whatever it might be. Ultimately, I believe that the comfort comes from the scriptures. The comfort comes from knowing God's will, knowing God's direction for our lives. And I just want to share with you the devotional process that I went through over the last couple of weeks in finding the comfort and the direction of God in my life. So if you got your Bibles, go with me to the book of John. John chapter 18. John chapter 18, as I was reading and I was praying, I said, God, okay, I need some direction. God, I need some help. I need some thoughts. I was just kind of reading through the Bible, and I just kind of opened up my Bible here to John, and I was reading, you know, the Jesus. I love John chapter 15, probably one of the greatest books or chapters of scripture right there. John chapter 15, John chapter 16, 17, Jesus' prayer. And then all of a sudden, I get into John chapter 18, and now we find ourselves, the story here, Jesus is before Pontius Pilate. And Jesus says these amazing words. Now, I gave the video department more scriptures than I'm actually going to read to you. But let's just look at this in John chapter 18. Pilate, basically the background here is that Jesus has gone before Pilate. The high priests have taken Jesus and they've arrested him after the garden. You know that after Judas's betrayal, and they've questioned him, and now he's before the Roman officiate, Pontius Pilate, and Pontius begins to ask him certain questions and question him based on the accusations that have been brought against Jesus. And he asks him this question, are you the king of the Jews? Because that's one of their arguments, is that he's raising a rebellion against the Rome, and he's calling himself the king of the Jews. And so Jesus begins to answer back to Pontius, and he asks him, you know, are you asking this question? Do you really want to know if I'm the king of the Jews? Or, you know, he has a way of leading to where he wants to go. And in John the 18th chapter, as I was reading, this is what really jumped out to me. In verse number 36, Jesus says in John chapter 18, Jesus says, and Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight so that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now my kingdom is not from here. Then Pilate therefore said to him, are you a king then? So are you admitting to me, the Roman officiant, that you are proclaiming yourself as a king? And Jesus comes back and he says, you say rightly that I am a king. For this cause I was born, and for this cause I have come into the world, that I should bear witness to the truth. And everyone is of the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. And as I was reading that, I was kind of trying to figure out, okay, Lord, what are you trying to speak to me? And I began to realize that in my heart, we live in this kind of awkward position because we have this state of dual citizenship. You know what I'm talking about when I say dual citizenship? I have a family member. They're a citizen of a South Africa, and they're a citizen of the United States. They can go either way. They have dual citizenship, which means that they are legally a citizen of two countries. And we as Christians, and especially today in our day and age, we as Americans, or we as those who dwell in this country, regardless of status, we find ourselves allied or citizens or members of, in our hearts and our minds and our thinking, of this great country, America. Or our hearts might lie with our nationality somewhere else. But the truth is, like Jesus says, I am a king, but my kingdom is not of this world. That we are also citizens of another kingdom, the kingdom of God. Like Pastor Dan brought us there in Hebrews, the 13th chapter there, that the kingdom that cannot be shaken, that nothing can destroy. I was reading this morning in my devotions, reading about Daniel, and Daniel talking about, you know, the everlasting kingdom that cannot be shaken. And you see, so we have this kind of a hardship, or we have this kind of teeter-totter, we have this balancing act of, okay, I have my loyalties, I have my national pride, Okay, and I know Pastor Dan taught a message a couple of months ago. Oh, that was like years ago now. But we shouldn't say we're proud of anything, you know, because pride's not a good thing. But we have this national pride. We're glad, you know, I'm proud to be an American, whatever. And so I have this, and so my frustrations were, you know, this country, this set of principles, this ideal that I was basing my life off of, basing off my blessing off of, was going in a direction that I was displeased with. And because of that, it set off some emotions on the inside of me that, you know, I was having a hard time. I was frustrated. I was feeling down. I was a little bit upset. But then at the same time, God began to speak to me through the words of Jesus Christ, reminding me, listen, you may be a citizen, you may be a national born American, but you know what? You are not a citizen of the United States. You are ultimately a citizen, a member of the kingdom of God. Like Jesus says, my kingdom is not from here. So then the question began to arise to me, okay, so what do I do? Because oftentimes I have this pull, okay? So our country says we want to go this way, and God says I want to go this way, and I feel like I'm being pulled in this direction, and then I feel like I need to go in this direction, and I feel like I'm being torn, and then the question arises in me, in my own heart, and my own frustrations, and my own curiosity. What do I do? What does the Bible say? Where do we go from here? What can I do? What difference can I make? And as I was beginning to read in my study time, as the Spirit of God was just speaking to me, I believe He gave me some just encouragement. Maybe you're in this place and you felt like I did. Maybe you're in this place and you kind of, man, I just don't know what to make of this. I mean, I don't know what to go. Or maybe you're in this place and you're glad. And you know what? To each their own. I'm not going to dwell on that. But the fact of the matter is that the Bible gives us some things about the Word of God, about what we can do as members of this kingdom, the kingdom of God. And what we can do and how we can live our lives, and just some direction, some perspective, that if we can carry out this perspective, man, I believe that our lives won't be rattled by the decisions. Our lives won't be shaken when things don't go our way. Because, man, I'll tell you what, I really don't like it when things don't go my way. Can anybody else relate in that one? I mean, when things don't go my way, I'm just not a happy guy. But we can get beyond that. We can go and we can be solid. We can continue. We can have joy. We can have fulfillment. We don't have to let these things shake us and let these things pull us down, because we realize with perspective through the Word of God that we are members of a greater kingdom. A kingdom that's not forged by the hands of men. A kingdom that's not brought into or managed by humanity or mankind. A kingdom that's not based on this precept here and this precept here and this worked over here and this worked over here. This is a kingdom based on God Almighty, the creator of the universe. A perfect kingdom where there is no darkness, where there is no sin, where there is no weeping or there is no pain. This is the kingdom that you and I belong to. And as I was in my study, man, the Spirit of God came alive in me in this section of Scripture. So I want you to just go with me. We'll just go through it. Just look at some perspective tonight. And even if you don't care about what's going on currently in the nation, okay, this is still great for you to grab some perspective of the kingdom of God in our lives. And so if you would, go with me to the book of 1 Peter. 1 Peter in the second chapter. We were here a couple of weeks ago. Pastor Dan brought some reference to this as well. Just this last weekend. And so I just was in my study, and I had planned on actually doing this message on Sunday night. I didn't even know Pastor Dan's message, but, you know, God just saved it for the right time. And so I just thought I'd go through it, 1 Peter, chapter number 2. And let's just read this. And I want to just go through and come back and look at some of these little tidbits, some of these little nuggets that he's writing here. And we'll just look at this, just apply these to our lives, some perspective for you and I. 1 Peter, chapter 2, I know I keep going back and forth. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse number 11. Peter says, "Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among Gentiles, that they might speak, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme or to governors or to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men, as free, yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice." Holy cow, that's a that little sentence right there, man.
but as bondservants of God, honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king.
In my study, as I was going through this, and it's just my own emotions and what I was dealing with at the time, God brought me to this section of scripture, and as I began to study, the Holy Spirit just began to speak to me and show me some revelations and just show me some truth, show me some perspective of my life, and to realize that my mind was the reason this had gotten me so down, the reason that I had allowed, you know, my own emotions to get so much of me is because my alliance, my allegiance, so to say, was in the wrong place. I was focused more on the kingdom of man than the kingdom of God. So I just want to go back. Let's just look at some of these verses and just look at what Peter's saying here. In verse number 11, Peter says this. Let's just pop it back up and we can just leave it up as we talk about it. Peter says this. He says, "Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims." You see, the first nugget that God gave me of inspiration, of direction in my own life is that we have to realize that we're just travelers. That ultimately you may have citizenship to this country or to another country. You're living in a time right now where you are a member of a nation of some place on earth today. But you are just a traveler right now. This is not your final destination. You and I, because of the invitation of Jesus Christ, by accepting Jesus, we have been adopted, have been grafted into the family. And now because of that, we are members. We are citizens of the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, our mindset we have got to maintain in our own minds, despite what happens to our nation, despite what happens to our ordinances, despite what happens in the direction that we want to go or we don't want to go, when things go our way or they don't go our way, that we are just travelers through life right now, and our final destination is the kingdom of God, the kingdom that Jesus spoke about when he spoke to Pontius Pilate. And we have to have that mindset, to have that understanding that, listen, I am blessed to be an American man. You know, when I get a grip of that perspective, when I realize, you know what, that I have already won the lottery. You know what I mean? Because I was born in America. When there are billions of people around the world that would die for our freedoms, that have died trying to establish the freedoms that we enjoy so casually today, I begin to realize, you know what, I am blessed despite the direction one goes or the other goes. You know why? Because ultimately I am a member of the kingdom of God. And when I realize and I recognize that my citizenship doesn't lie in a blue passport, but rather my citizenship lies in my heart because of my relationship with Jesus Christ, the world can crumble around me and I will not be shaken because I know that I am walking on a journey to my final destination. Listen, you don't go to the movies for the previews. Don't get so wrapped up on the sideshow that you miss the attraction, the main attraction. We get so wrapped up. We get so busy. We get so focused on what's going here that we lose sight. And that was what happened to me, is that I was so focused on what was going on the here and now that I had lost the perspective that God is an eternal God who has no time, who knows beginning from end, that everything will be made clear in my life. But all I need to do is sit back and trust that God is in control despite the direction my life might be going. Why? Because I am a member of the kingdom of God. We get so wrapped up, it's so easy. Just the other day, I was, you know, we're the kind of people that we see our home as base camp. I found in life that there are two types of people. Home is castle or home is base camp. Like, you know, some people, home is just, I don't want to go anywhere but home. They got the big chair that they've had for 40 years and it's got duct tape because it's like the place to be, you know what I mean? The throne. And then there are other people like us where home is just where we sleep, like, you know, whatever. So we have all the stuff piled up and my garage got a little out of control. And I told my wife, you know, I'm going to clean the garage. Praise God. Hallelujah. So I got to cleaning the garage. About 3 minutes into cleaning the garage, I saw this old woodworking project on the other side of my garage that I started and didn't finish like 3 years ago. And I thought to myself, man, I'm going to finish that. So I moved everything out of the way, and I finished this little woodworking project to me all day, and I hung it on there. My wife comes back, she's like, what did you do? I'm like, look, I made the shelf. The garage, you know, it took longer than I expected because I got sidetracked. You see, it happens to us all the time. We get so focused on, we have a mission. Okay, man, I'm gonna follow God. I'm just not gonna let myself get shaken when things happen in my life. I'm gonna focus in on God, but then what happens is the sideshow comes on. That preview for that other movie of life, let's just say, metaphorically speaking, okay? All of a sudden, something happens and attracts our attention. Ooh, what is that? Oh my goodness, can you believe? And fear comes in. Oh, I can't believe. And we lose sight of the bigger picture. The fact of the matter is we are members of the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, we should not be shaken. We should not let the left or the right stop us what's going on because we have Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We've got to get that perspective, church. We are travelers journeying through. Peter says, I beg you as sojourners and as pilgrims to have that mindset that even though we are citizens or we dwell or we live here today, this is not our final destination, but rather the sideshow. That's a pretty good sideshow. Now, verse number 12 comes along and he says this, and he says, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. This is where I really began to think about the current situation and the things going on. You know, we have got to maintain honorable conduct as Christians. Honorable conduct. Now, honorable conduct is not just, okay, I'm going to stand at least, can I step on some toes for a moment? Honorable conduct is not, I'm going to stand on my soapbox and tell the world how bad everything else they're doing is because I've got everything together. Honorable conduct is following and living and acting and walking in the will and the ways of God, using Jesus Christ as our example of how we dwell, of how we operate. That's why the Bible tells us, therefore, let us be imitators of Christ. Why? Because he is ultimately the example for you and I. Yet he told, let those who have no sin cast the first stone. You say, remember he tells us in his sermon, remove the plank before you talk about the other person's speck. But yet what happens for us is far too many Christians in our day and age forget that despite the fact that we have freedoms to say or to do or to voice whatever we think we can because of our constitution gives us that right, that does not give us the ability or the justification to do so. And far too many people in the name of Jesus Christ have done what thousands have done, thousands or hundreds of thousands have done over the thousands of years of Christian history, have taken the name of God and trampled it for their own agendas. Honorable conduct is not saying what we want to say because we're emotional. Church, honorable conduct is not doing what I necessarily want to do because that's how I feel like doing it, but rather honorable conduct is, remember back in the 90s, WWJD? They had something on that little bracelet that went around your wrist. What would Jesus do? See, far too many people take to social media, far too many people take to blogs, or far many people take to stickers or whatever it might be to voice their opinion because they've been given the freedom nationally to do so. But when God says to you and I, we are ambassadors to Christ. And because we are ambassadors to Christ, we have to be very judicious about what we say and what we do, because otherwise we paint a negative picture of our Lord and Savior. We paint a bad picture of the kingdom that we so are so blessed to belong to. And church, we have got to learn how to hold our tongue. Oh man, I know I'm stepping on some of your toes because you're like, man, I love those political posts. Oh, I love it when somebody goes on and they paste a little meme. You know what I'm talking about? Memes, those random pictures. Listen, it's not necessary for you and I. We can't always act how we feel. Oh, let me tell you something. A couple of weeks ago, I drove, right after doing three services on a Sunday morning, I drove to take my to take some family members camping. So I drove all the way up to Bishop and past Mammoth. So it was a 7-hour drive. I got to Bishop right after three services on Sunday morning, got in the car and drove. And I was exhausted. I was grubby. I had my basketball shorts on and they were dirty. I had my t-shirt on and I had chips all over and I was at the gas station. You know where I'm going with this? Because I've told a story about the gas station before. I always have bad experiences at the gas station. I was at the gas station and all of a sudden this woman comes around and I'm like, here it comes. Man. You know, and I was just teaching about we were teaching on the series of blessed life, and the message of the blessed life was that we use our resources that we have today to build the kingdom of God so that the people that we have used to build the kingdom of God will welcome us into eternity. Yes. And this lady comes up to me and she says, sir, I'm so sorry to bother you. And I'm like, lay it on me. So she tells me, I need some gas, I'm traveling. And you know, she's got this look on her face, and I look at her and say, all right, you know what, well, let me look to see if I have any cash in my car. And I'm like, conduct. I'll just tell her I don't carry cash because that's like the easiest default answer. I don't have any cash, sorry. And she looks at me and she starts to cry, just weeping. She says, I don't want cash. I just need gas. And it was just like, man, the Spirit of God came on me and just said, okay, you know what I told her? I said, pick a pump. I'll fill you up. And I took my card out there, and we were out there in Bishop in the middle of the night. I'm grubby, and she's just crying. I started talking to her, and she's had some poor life decisions, and some things fell through in her life. And there I am, and she says, you know, just give me $10 of gas to get to the next city. And I just says, you know what? No, we're going to go the whole way. And so we just filled her tank all the way up to the very top. And I looked at her, and she's just crying, and I asked her what her name was. And I just told her, I said, you know what? If anything you need to know today, you need to know that God loves you. Jesus Christ loves you. And she just started crying, and she just says, I needed to hear that. And I told her about the church, because she ended up coming to our area, and she says, I got to go back to this area. And I said, well, just so happens that there's a church in this area, and then we'd love to do what we can to help you out, get reestablished and get reaffirmed. But you see, my own personal perspective, my own personal opinion, I was tired. I preached 4 services that weekend. I'm exhausted. Drove 7 hours in the car. And as soon as somebody comes up to me, and it's just like, man, I don't want to do anything but get gas in my car and get and go, because I'm about to fall asleep on the road. But yet, God wanted me to take time out of my schedule in that moment to share the gospel. You see, our conduct, despite how we feel, I want to voice my opinion. But godly conduct says, hey, you know what? That may not be the time to do it. Because somebody is watching. Somebody is watching. If there's one thing I've learned growing up as a pastor's kid with Pastor Jim and Pastor Deborah, all my life, no matter what you do, somebody is always watching. Because of that, we have to keep our conduct godly as representatives of the kingdom that we so belong to keep our godly conduct. Look what it says in verse number 13 now, moving on. This next nugget was so important. It says, therefore, submit yourself to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake. Whether to the king as supreme, I'm going to read verse number 15 as well. Whether to the king as supreme, for this is the will of God. Oh, verse number 14. Or to governors, or to those who are set by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. He says, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man. Go back. To every ordinance of man. You know that word ordinance literally means, the word ordinance there means institution. Every institution. You see, as Christians, as godly Christians, as godly citizens of the kingdom of heaven, we have got to live an exemplary life submitting to the institutions of the governmental systems despite our agreements, despite what we think or what we don't, because God set up a system of hierarchies in our lives. And here, think about it. Let me just give you a painting of what's going on right here. Peter is writing this. He says, I write you from Babylon. That literally means that most theologians agree that when Peter refers to writing from Babylon, that means that Peter is writing from Rome, the epicenter of the Roman Empire. He's writing in a time that is under heavy persecution, likely under the Emperor Nero, in which Peter later on and Paul later on go to face their own death. He's literally writing in a time where people are being dragged out of their homes and crucified and killed for the very name of Jesus Christ. And yet, despite all that's going on in the name of Jesus Christ and what's going on, he says to them, I want you to submit yourselves to the ordinance or to the institution of man for God's sake. Not for yours, not for mine, but for God's sake. He says, I want you to live a model citizen. Why? Because at the time, Christians were seen as separatists. Christians were seen as enemies of the state. I mean, you see what happened with Peter and Paul, and they were locked up and they were continually going against everything that was going on. And at the time, there was animosity growing between the government of Rome and the Jewish culture. And just a few years after this was written, Jerusalem was completely destroyed because of a rebellion against Rome. Not one church, not one building was left standing in the city of Jerusalem because of their rebellion to the government. And he's saying, for the sake of God, for the witness, for the testimony, to live peaceably among all men. Peter says this. Paul backs this up in Romans, the 13th chapter, and again in the book of Titus, telling you and I that we have got to be model citizens, that we have got to respect our authority despite our agreement or disagreement to our authority. And that one is a difficult one when it comes politically, because you know what? At any given time in history, either half the country loves the administration or half the country hates the administration. It's just the way it goes. So despite whether you think that the nation or the country or the city or the state that you live in is going in the direction that you want or you don't, we have got to, by the call of God, for the sake of God, for the sake of the testimony of God, to live peaceably and to do what we can to be a model citizen, that we don't bring uprising against, but rather we are an example. Somebody that says, man, that's not a Christian that's painting a mixed message of this over here and that over here. One that thumps about love on one end and one that thumps about bigotry on the other end. But rather, we are model citizens. And I know that that's tough. I know that that's hard. But the truth of the matter is that we have got to respect authority here on earth. Why? Because if we can't respect authority on earth with man, how is it that we'll respect authority of God when our flesh disagrees? Y'all right? Because that was dismal. Think about that for a moment. If we have a hard time respecting the authority that's placed in the position right now, and we disagree or we agree, but we have a hard time, how then will we respect the authority of God and reverence the authority of God when our flesh kicks and screams and tries to run the opposite direction because the Word of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ will rub our fleshly nature the wrong way? See, he's saying, for God's sake, for the testimony, you and I have got to learn to live peaceably, to respect our authority, whether we agree with it or not. Man, I'll tell you what, we live in a time where there's an uprising. And yes, absolutely, there's corruption. Absolutely, without a doubt, there's corruption on all levels. But you know what? That doesn't have to stop us from being a model example to say, you know what, I'll respect my authority. Paul the Apostle says, man, in Romans, the 13th chapter, you don't have to worry about the authorities. If you do good, if you do what you're supposed to do, you won't have to worry about what's going on because you're doing what they're asking you to do. You see, we've got to live a model life as Christians to respect our authorities, as hard and as difficult as that might be, to submit to that institution. Look at verse number 15. We'll move on. Verse number 15, he says, for this is the will of God, that by doing so you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. And verse number 16 kind of carries that over on the second part of that. As free, yet not using a liberty as a cloak for vice. Oh my goodness. But as bond servants for Christ. You see, the perspective for you and I to understand in our lives and the fact that we are members of the kingdom of God is that we are bond servants to Christ. Paul the Apostle tells us in the book of Romans that we are no longer slaves to sin. That we are no longer servants to the sin nature of humanity, but now we are free from the laws of sin and death, but that brings us into our new position that we are now slaves to righteousness. That there is no such thing as Christianity in the world that does not involve personal sacrifice. Now that's not going to get anybody's amen, and I understand that. Why? Because we want to live this religion. We want to live this system of beliefs that as long as it doesn't affect the way I think, the way I want things to go, as long as everything's hunky-dory with my mentality and the way it lines up with how I want things to go, then I'm all in on it. But when it comes time for me to pick up my cross and you want me to lay that down, or you want me to stop this, or you want me to not do that, you want me to not say this, or you want me to not go over here, well, now all of a sudden I got a problem. But you see, Jesus tells us that we have got to pick up our cross and follow him. There is no such thing as Christianity, church, without personal sacrifice. That's why Paul tells us in Romans chapter number 12, verse number 1, it's our reasonable service to God that we must die to ourselves. That if you come into this place and you don't want to give up what you're doing, but you want to come and hear the pastor preach, listen, I'll tell you what, you'll get some good Reader's Digest suggestions, but your life will never change until you decide to give your life to Jesus Christ and become a slave to righteousness. Your life will never change like you want it to change. But when we have the slave, when we become slaves to righteousness, when we realize that I am a representative, I am an ambassador to Christ with my godly conduct, that everything I do should be weighed against what God sees of my life because Jesus Christ died on the cross, and I will not use the freedoms that I have been given as a cloak for my vices because I don't have to live with them anymore. I have been set free in the name of Jesus. Who I once was, I don't have to be. Church, listen. As a man, I'll tell you the truth. It's as a man in the nature of man. Guys, you know what I'm talking about. Hey, I like window shopping. Sorry, babe. The guys all like to say, man, ain't nothing hurt by looking. Well, Jesus says no. He says, no, you can't do that. You lust for a woman, and with your eyes, you're committing adultery already. It means I gotta lay myself down, which means I gotta stop doing the things that I wanna do and do the things that God says to do. Why? Because I can through the grace of Jesus Christ. Christianity's not asking one group of people to stop doing what they think that they should be doing. Christianity's telling every person that comes to Jesus Christ to stop living life your way and start living it Jesus' way. That's the way it goes. To not use the freedoms as a cloak for our vice, but rather the grace of God to enable us to get beyond who we were to become who Jesus Christ has called us to be. Amen. Drop the mic. I'm done right there. Keep going. Look at verse number 7 says, this is where I really wanted to, and this is what God really spoke to me. This is the golden nugget, so to verse number 17. Honor all people. Honor all people. Man, that was tough. That was tough. There's just things in this world that I just don't want to honor people with. Because we see honor as acceptance. So accept, just get over it, go beyond, you know. And I'm not just talking about the LGBT thing. Listen, if you're in here, and that's, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about there's all sorts of different things. And watch TV. It's not just one group of people. This is humanity. And he says, honor all people. Man, that's tough. But then I looked up that word honor in the Greek. You know what that word honor means? Value. Oh. Yes. All of a sudden, it makes sense. Value all people. Value all people. Yes. Man, people are tough. Drive on the 10 freeway at 5 o'clock or at 8 o'clock. No, forget the 10. Drive on the 91, hallelujah, at any time of the day. People are tough. I don't want to value. Listen, I drive a minivan, I know. When you drive a mini, Pastor Paul, you know what I'm talking about? When you drive a minivan, it just has cut me off written all over it. I might be in the fast lane going a little too fast, disobeying the laws, all right? But it still has cut me off written all over it. It has sucker, especially when it's a man driving. Sucker. When it's a woman, it's soccer, all right? But it is tough to like people. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Man, it is tough. You read about some of the things that are going on in the news. You read about some of the laws that they're making and all these different things about, you know, all the different things that are going on. It's like, you made a law because of that? Like, one person fell in a hole, and so you're going to make everybody else stop doing what they're doing because one person got, you kidding me? It is hard to love people. But when you look at that word, honor all people, and you realize that that word honor means value, you begin to see people not for their frustrations, not for sometimes their senselessness or for their lack of common sense, but we begin to see people how God sees people. Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Why? Because Jesus Christ did just that. He valued humanity. And so the person that I disagree with, the person that I have complete opposition to, I still see value. Why? Because they were created in the image of God, and God's desire is that they would not perish without knowing him. And I have got to do my job as a citizen of heaven to value that person, to get along, to love, to wave with all five fingers in my minivan. To value people, because God values you. God values me. God values people across the world that we have no concept of. And when we see value in humanity, it restores our mission. Because no longer do we become like Moses and frustrated and not want to talk to people, not want to do our job as Christians, but now all of a sudden we realize that God has a value for humanity. And I am the tool, the ambassador, the vessel in which the love of God will be displayed, because I am a member of the kingdom of God. And because I am a member of the kingdom of God, I will make it a choice in my life to value people of all walks of life, because God valued them enough to send Jesus to die for them. It says I should value them too. Love the brotherhood. Church, we gotta stay together. Listen, Bible tells us it's gonna get darker before it gets lighter, all right? Dark, like Pastor Dan, you said, how do you say it? The light shines brighter, the darker it gets. We've got to stay together as Christians to support each other, to pray for each other, to build each other up. I want to encourage you, get involved. Don't just come and be a face in the crowd and walk out. That's great. That's wonderful. You get the word of God and that changes your life. But get involved. Get to know somebody in church. Why? Because we've got to love, to value, to appreciate the brotherhood. Why? Because we lean on each other to get through hard times, to pray for each other, to work with each other, to build and to lift each other up. A three-strand cord is not easily broken. Church, let's get together and band. As the night gets darker, let's let our light shine brighter because we are unified in Jesus Christ. Fear God. I think it was C.S. Lewis that said, you shouldn't care so much about what men think about you as so much as what God thinks about you. Fear God. Godly fear, a healthy respect for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Because remember how I said there's always somebody watching? There's always somebody watching. It's not so much what men think of us. What would the Bible have been like if the Apostle Paul cared about what man thought of him? Or Peter? Or James? Or John? If they cared so much about the perspective and the opinions, but see, we count the likes on our social media. Well, I posted this scripture versus this political thing, and I got 2 likes versus the 150 likes over there. Let's stop caring about what men think about us and start focusing on what God thinks about us. Honor the King. Church, we hear far too many Christians speak far too negatively about our elected officials. You may hate the people that are in office. But our job is to pray for them, to believe in God for them, to support them, despite our agreement with them or not. And we should stop or should lay back on the hate speeches of this group over here or this person over here, and we should kick up our prayers for this nation. It's easy to complain, man. Hey, it's so easy to complain. It's fun. Because you don't have to do anything. You have no responsibility. But let's stop complaining. Stop griping about what's going on over here and let's start praying. When you feel like complaining, when you feel like making those statements, when you feel like posting those posts, you know what? Take a minute and pray for them. Didn't Jesus say, bless those who persecute you?
Yes, he did.
See, maybe we just have our perspective misaligned. Maybe if we just think about the fact that we are members, citizens of the kingdom of heaven, that despite what happens to us right here, right now, this is just a journey we're traveling on, an adventure. And any adventure is going to have ups and it's going to have downs, but our final destination will take us to a place that we can't even comprehend. I love how Paul the Apostle describes it in 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter. He says it like this. He says, see, we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face, I know in part, but then I shall know just also as I am known. I remember my wife and I, we took a trip up the coast. We drove up the Pacific Coast Highway. And in the morning, we were driving up the Pacific Coast Highway. It was a beautiful drive. It was this windy road up above San Simeon up to on the way to Monterey. It was so foggy, we couldn't see anything. All we could see was the yellow lane. I had to look out the window and make sure that I was driving. I could see the yellow line on the left side of the car. If I saw the yellow line on the left side of the car, everything was okay. That's all I could see. I couldn't see what was ahead of me. I couldn't see what was on this side of the road. I couldn't see what was on that side of the road. Life is a lot like that in this journey. We're kind of on this foggy road. We don't see what's ahead of us. Don't even see necessarily what's behind us because life moves on so fast. But if we just focus in on the direction, if we just focus in on the fact that we are members of the kingdom of God, that we are traveling through, if we focus in on the line ahead of us, if we focus in on the direction that God has given us, if we keep our eyes fixed on Him and we live according to the will and the word of God through Jesus Christ and His apostles, then we will travel that journey. And on the way home, that road was crystal clear. Everything was clear. Now all of a sudden we realized that two people, deathly afraid of heights at the time, were driving on like 1,000-foot cliffs with no guardrails. The journey was a lot easier when it was in the fog than it was when everything was lit up. But let me tell you something. That's exactly like what is going on with us. We don't have the grand perspective. But you see, God is not bound by time. Time exists in God. He knows the beginning from the end. He knows your life before it began, and He knows your life after it'll end. But all we can do is live according to God's way, follow the directions of Jesus Christ, and we will find our way on that windy journey through the foggy road, and we will find ourselves arriving at the destination that we have been intended to get to, the kingdom of heaven. Don't let fear, don't let discouragement, don't let frustration derail you from your journey. Because ultimately, we live a foggy life, but there will be a time when we see clearly, face to face. Everything that happens will become clear, and we will say, God, you had everything in control the whole time. Let's trust in God. Let's lift up our leaders, church. Let's lift up our nation. Let's do the best we can to be a model citizen. And I'll say this. I'm not saying that you have to abide by every rule, because the church of the first church, they didn't abide by every rule. They went to death. They went to the Colosseum because they would not abide. I'm not saying that you got to listen to every rule. But you got to do the best you can and not be somebody that causes dissension in your nation. For the sake of God, for the testimony of Jesus Christ. That you, first and foremost, your allegiance is to the Word of God. Those are the rules that you follow. And if the laws of your nation tell you to not follow the laws of your God, you must pick who you will follow. Choose this day who you will follow. As for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. Why? Because I'm a member of the kingdom of God. Did you guys get something out of that today? Hey, listen, before we leave today, I don't know everybody in this place. And because of that, it would be terrible for us to leave under the pretense, under the assumption that everybody's right with God, everybody's in the right position, everybody's good and everything's okay in your relationship with God, when the truth of the fact is that there are many of you in this place that might not be right with God. And so I just want to ask you to do me a favor, just give me a moment more of your attention. Don't get up, don't leave, don't walk around, don't check your phone. I'll let you out in a couple of minutes. I want you to just pay very close attention to what I'm saying right now, because your eternal life is at stake. The Bible says that a man ought to examine himself from time to time. And I want you just to look in your heart, to look in your life, and to answer this question that I'm about to ask open and honestly. Nobody will know the answer except you and God. It's not about, you know, the outward appearance. It's about an open and honest question. The question is this. If you were to leave tonight and you were to die, heaven forbid that be the case, but if you were to leave tonight and die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You see, I'm not trying to cast fear or worry on your life, but the truth is that life is a very fragile thing here on earth, that we're all one virus, we're all one accident, we're all one epidemic or incident away for our eternal destiny. The Bible is very clear on what happens, that we have one of two options when we die. We'll either go to heaven or we'll go to hell. So the question I want to ask you is, will you go to heaven or will you go to hell? Well, you know, I don't know how I feel on that. I haven't landed quite on whether or not it's true. You know, I heard about that book, and then I heard about over here the person said that it wasn't real. And I just don't know, Pastor. Look, I haven't seen that. Listen, just because you haven't seen it, because you haven't experienced it, doesn't mean that it's not real. Listen, there's things all over this world that we know that we can't see, we can't feel, but we know that they're real. Just case in point, radio waves right now from me to the sound booth, because you can hear the sound of my voice. You know they exist, but yet you don't see them. You see, just because you can't see or heaven's not tangible to you right now, the kingdom of heaven, as Jesus tells us, might not be tangible to you physically. It's a very real place. Real enough for God to speak about it. Real enough for Jesus to teach us about it. Real enough for the Bible to be preserved over thousands of years so that we might take it seriously today. Burying your head in the sand doesn't make it go away. So the question is, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? How you answer that question has a lot to say about your position with God. And I'd just like to go over that for a moment. You know, nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you can hope, that you can think, that you can want, that you can desire or wish that you're going to get to heaven, that God looks at you and says, well, you had the most positive outlook on life. You wished enough. I thought I can. I thought I could. I thought I could. Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you can have that type of mentality and that's going to get you into heaven and that's good enough. It's not. Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you were baptized or christened as a baby and somebody blew smoke and water over you, that your godparents made a promise for you when you were too young to make a commitment for yourself. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you go to church and you hear the pastor preach That because you put money in the offering bucket as it goes by, nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you're going to get to heaven because of those things. You can't find that in the Word of God. So often we think, well, I've given myself the title. We as Americans, man, we love to label ourselves, to associate ourselves with this or with that. So we like to give ourselves, well, you know, the census came around and it asked me all these different things, and I'm not a Hindu or a Buddhist or a Muslim or anything else, so I thought I meant I was a Christian. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself a title, that because you wear a cross around your neck or when the census came around and knocking on your door, that you labeled or you checked the box Christian, that means you're going to get to heaven. It goes so far beyond what we label ourselves or what we call ourselves. I can label myself a car, sit in my garage, but you know what? At no point in my life does that make me a car. Just because you've given yourself the title, because your parents told you as a child growing up that you were a Christian, nowhere does that say in the Word of God that that's going to get you in heaven. You can't get there that way. You see, ultimately, the only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way. We can't earn it. We can't work for it. We can't buy it. We didn't deserve it. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, yet we work hard. If I'm just a good person, if I do the best I can, if I stand for social justice, or if I live for a cause, good people go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that? The Bible tells us that our good deeds according to God's righteousness are like filthy rags. You see, nothing you and I could ever do on our own would ever make us good enough to get into heaven. But that doesn't have to be the end result. Because you see, the only way we can get to God's heaven is God's way. And Jesus Christ is that way. Jesus says that He is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one goes to the Father except through Him. So today I want to give you the opportunity to accept the gift of God. You see, the Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. And like any gift, man, you've had them on Christmas and on birthdays and on special occasions. You have the choice. Are you going to accept or reject or return that gift? It's your choice. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to come and force His way or make His way in. See, God has given you an intellect, a free will choice to decide for yourself whether you'll accept Jesus Christ or you won't. Today I want to give you that opportunity. Jesus, in the book of John in the 3rd chapter, speaking to a religious man, Jesus tells him, in order to see, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, He says, you must be born again. Oh, born again. I've seen the movies. I've read what they said about that on the internet. Listen, it's not what you think it is. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, born again has always meant the same thing in the heart and the eyes of God. Here it is. It means that you've given God all of your heart. It means that you've given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. In the book of Revelation, the very last book of the Bible, Jesus' final plea to you and I, to the church. He says to the church, He says, I'm coming back. And when I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot or I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. What a shocking statement. You see, that's the final plea of Jesus Christ to His people to tell us, stop doing life your way. Stop trying to do things on your own and start doing them God's way, because that's the only way you and I will arrive in heaven with God. What does it mean to be lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means that you've got your ups and your downs and your ins and your outs. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. Listen, you know, in any relationship you ever had in your life, whether it be a friendship, an intimate relationship, or a business partnership, that if you were to go to that person and say, I want to give you the very minimum of my effort, the very minimum of my time, and I want this to succeed and grow, you know that that relationship would never flourish, it would never grow. But yet we think we can do that with God by coming to church every once in a while, giving Him a token prayer here and again, doing a little bit here and doing a little bit there, and then living our lives the rest of the time the way we want to. Listen, let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough today to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it that way. You're not going to make it based on your own devices, based on your hopes, your wishes, or your wants. But that doesn't have to be the end. Why? Because Jesus Christ came, and He says, I have come that you might have life, that you might have it abundantly. You've been trying to do life your way, filling it with toys and resources and things going on, hobbies and friendships and relationships and men and women or whatever it might be. No matter how much you try to feed the thirst, fill the emptiness on the inside of you, you realize that no matter what you do, no matter how much you pour into your life, there's always an emptiness on the inside of you. Why? Because it's a God-sized hole. And Jesus Christ says, I have come to give you life, a fulfillment. It's not even so much what happens when you die as it is what happens right here today in your life. Abundant life through Jesus Christ, the gift of God. And today I want to give you that opportunity to accept that gift. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess Him before men, He will confess you before His Father. He says, but if you deny Him, He will deny you. The decision's yours. Today I'm going to do this. I'll count to three. I'll go 1, 2, and then on the count of three, I'll go 3. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. When I do, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. Oh, man, I don't know if I can do that, Pastor Luke. If I put my hand up, I'm going to be embarrassed. I'm not going to embarrass you. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, you know what? I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. You're making a decision. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. And we'll go forward together from there. But today it starts by making that decision. Who should raise your hands in a moment when I count to three, if that's you? If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus. Listen, if that's you in just a moment, get ready. Who should raise your hands? If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child at a Harvest Crusade or you prayed that prayer once before on TV, but you've never really followed through with it. Listen, oh, don't walk out of here without making sure. That's a gamble on your eternal life you can't afford to make. Listen, my grandfather, despite the fact that he knew he was destined to expire soon, didn't know the moment. You don't know the moment. Don't walk out of this place without knowing. Who should raise your hands today? If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, listen, come on. Quit playing games with God. Quit messing around. Today, it's time for you to accept the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, to accept the fulfillment of life through Jesus today and stop doing life your way. Start doing it God's way and see that it's better. But it starts by making that decision. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. Today, it's a divine appointment. You're here for a reason. And it's time for you to respond. I'm going to count to three in just a moment. Wherever you're at, from side to side, front to back, you guys in the family rooms, I can see you through the windows. If you're outside on the campus and you're watching or you're listening to the sound of my voice, or even if you're at home right now in just a moment, you can do it right now if you'd like. You can minimize the screen. There's a little blue button that says, "No God." Click on that button. Somebody will pray with you. If that's you in this place today, this is your moment. This is your time. Don't wait another minute. Today is the day of your salvation. When I count to three, if that's you, pop your hand up. Be bold and be proud about it. You're making a great decision, the best decision you can possibly make. And it's time for you to come home to Jesus. All across this auditorium, wherever you're at, speaking to you. And in just a moment, when I do, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. And put it right back down. We'll go forward together. You ready? I'm going to count to three. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two. I see those hands over there. Two wise people. Anybody else? Three. I got you right over there. I got that hand right there. I got you right there too. Three wise people. Anybody else in this place? Four. I see it right there in the back. All right. Four wise people. Anybody else? You say, man, I wonder if I should. Yes. Yes, you should. Five. I see that hand in the family rooms. All right. Cool. Anybody else in this place today say, man, I wonder if I should? Yes. The Bible tells us that it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. It's not me. It's not manipulation. It's not conniving. It's God speaking to you. And if God's speaking to you, it's time for you to respond. Stop doing life your way. Five wise people in this place today. Anybody else to say, man, I wonder if I should? I want to go forward with God today. All right, I see the hand. Praise God. I see you right over there. Six wise people. Anybody else in this place today? Well, let's praise God for six wise people. That's cool. That's great. Here's what we're going to do. For all of those of you that raised your hand, maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you know right on the inside, thinking, man, I missed it. Listen, it's not too late. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You make a decision. Like every decision you make, it requires action, follow through, and we're going to do that together. I'm going to leave you out of here empty-handed thinking that you can leave, but based on that, we're going to do that together. So if you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, in just a moment, we're all going to stand. And as we do, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend, if you need a friend. Those of you guys in the family rooms, if that's you, if you raise your hand, mom, dad, if they raise their hand, come on. My mom was 7 years old when she gave her heart to Jesus Christ. So if that's you in this place, you raise your hand, or you know you should have raised your hand. In just a moment, when we all stand, I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, come and meet me up here at this altar. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So let's all stand. Let's welcome them as they come forward. If that's you in this place, come on. It's time for you to come home. You in this place, you can come. Come on, they're still coming. We'll wait for you guys. In the family rooms, the ushers will help you get your stuff wherever you're at. It's too important for you to pass this up. This is your moment. This is your time. Jesus. done. Hey guys, listen, congratulations. Somebody needs to tell you that. Why? Because you're not going to a funeral. You're not going to the morgue, all right? You're going to a birthday celebration. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. You're gonna get born again, all right? It's the greatest decision you can possibly make as a human being. Somebody needs to tell you, good job. You're really smart. Great job, guys. Here's what I wanna do. I wanna introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy, really neat guy. He's gonna take you guys just right over there. Listen, nothing weird goes on, I promise, all right? You don't have to worry about any of that. He's gonna do a couple things with you. He's gonna lead you in a prayer. Okay, you don't get saved by raising your hand. That's making a decision. Remember I said that? Now it's time to act on it. You're gonna invite Jesus Christ into your life to be the Lord and Savior. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? The leader of your life. The second thing he's gonna do is we don't want you to leave here empty-handed. We wanna give you some material, some resources, really easy, simple reading to help point you in the right direction so that when you walk out of this place and say, what do I do next? We're gonna set you on the right path. The third thing he's gonna do is he's gonna invite you to come back, to hang out with us. We want you to get connected with us. We're not asking you to join a big, long program or anything like that. Simply, we just want you to come to one of our church services here and meet with somebody before church to buy a cup of coffee, get you a soda, sit down with you for just a couple of minutes to teach you some things about the Word of God. Like you go to the gym, you get a personal trainer, somebody to make sure you're using all that equipment the right way. We call them spiritual personal trainers, a friend, somebody that will come alongside of you for a couple of weeks, teach you some things about the Word of God so that you get strong in the ways of God and you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for you. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel, all right? Praise God.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.